start the preparation of alkenes. The first method in the preparation of alkene is by hydrogenation of alkynes. We know that if we remove one bond, one pi bond from the alkyne, then we get alkene. Just we have to remove one pi bond. So how can we remove it? By adding two hydrogen atoms. How can we add two hydrogen atoms? Just by this reaction. See, this first step or the first path is by Lindlar's catalyst. You have to just remember it. Lindlar's catalyst is hydrogen, addition of hydrogen in presence of catalyst, which is nothing but palladium in barium sulfate, and quinoline acts as a solvent. So if we apply this catalyst, then we get cis alkene. It is very important to remember Lindlar's catalyst gives only cis alkene. Cis alkene, we can see here, the hydrogen atoms are on the same side, so therefore we have said cis. And if we add sodium in liquid ammonia, which is called sodamide, sodium in liquid ammonia, if we apply it, then we get a transalkene. Transalkene is, however, we see here, the two hydrogen are on the opposite side of the double bond. So it's a transalkene. And the other catalyst can be used, like which is given in your book, B2H6 and CH3COH, and a Wilkinson catalyst, which is nothing but rhodium. It's a rhodium organometallic compound containing a triphenyl phosphine. Now we start the second method of preparation, that is the elimination reaction. Elimination reaction is also called dehydrohalogenation. Concentrate on the terms dehydrohalogen. Dehydrohalogen means one hydrogen atom and one chlorine atom is removed from the respective molecule which we have taken, that is alkyl halide, so that we form an alkene. So how do we do that? See, this is the general reaction. In this, a base is used which extracts a proton from the alkyl halide molecule from the beta position. So this is taken up by C2H5O negatives. For example, I have taken a base, and from here this bond gets transferred to form Cl negative ion, which then combines with the K positive to form KCl as a side product. So what we find, Cl is removed as Cl negative and H is taken up by the base in the form of proton, so that this bond gets transferred here, so we form CH2 double bond CH2, and C2H5OH is formed as a side product. Now this is a general reaction. Now if we get a different type of alkyl halide of the form RX, R can be anything, so we have to follow two types of mechanism. Mechanisms are called E1 and E2. Now we will study each in detail. First of all, the E1 reaction, E1 mechanism. What does E1 mechanism state? That E1 mechanism is a unimolecular mechanism. That is, the rate of the mechanism is found out by only one compound, that is the RX. If we write the rate equation in the form of rate is equal to rate constant K, the concentration of RX only. So it is a unimolecular reaction, that is why this we have written E1. 1 means unimolecular. And always you have to remember, if it is E1, then it is 2 step. If it is E2, then it is 1 step. We will find out afterwards that what does E2 mean. First of all, we will just see E1. E1 is a 2 step reaction. How the 2 steps are governed? First of all, we take an example of tertiary butyl halide, Cl. This is a delta negative charge, this is a delta positive charge. What happens in the first step? It's a slow step, which is the formation of carbocation. What happens? This bond is taken up by Cl negative, as it is more electronegative, to form Cl negative and the corresponding carbocation. In the next step, what happens? This was the first step, this was a slow step, and it determines the rate of the whole even mechanism. Second step, there is abstraction of proton by the respective base. Suppose RO negative we have taken, it extracts a proton. I write it CH2H. It extracts a proton in the form of H plus, and this bond gets transferred here. So we find an alkene is formed. Double bond CH2 with ROH as the side product. So first one, this was the fast step. So whatever we have to remember is that first step is the slow step, which is the formation of carbocation. The carbocation can be rearranged to form a more stable carbocation. Then afterwards, second step is the fast step, which means a removal of proton from any of the hydrogen atoms which are just next to the positive carbon by the base, such that it forms an alkene and a side product ROH. So secondly, we start the E2 mechanism. E2 mechanism, we have to see 2. 2 means bimolecular mechanism. Bimolecular means the rate is dependent on both the species, that is the alkyne halide and the base which we are using, like C2H5O negative. We have to take care that E2 mechanism only goes forward when a strong base is used, like R3N and etc. It is given further in your book in example that R3N when we use, we have to follow E2 mechanism. In E2 mechanism, I have told you E1 is 2 step, E2 is 1 step. So what happens in E2 mechanism, the base and the chloro, they start moving away from each other, away from the that RH molecule, and in 1 step, this is a transition stage. In the transition stage only, this bond starts forming C2H5O negative NH, and this bond starts breaking. This bond starts forming and this bond starts breaking by the solvents which we are using. So what we find ultimately that CH2 double bond CH2 is formed. One more important point about this is, here solvation means the solvent which we are using is solvating the Ca negative ion. The solvation will release some solvation energy, and this solvation energy with the pi bond formation energy, the pi bond is forming here, the pi bond formation energy and the solvation energy is enough to break the CCl bond. CCl bond means CH2Cl bond. Now we have two most important rules which determine the formation of the respective alkenes. The first one is the Sedzef's rule and the second one is the Hofmann's rule. When to use Sedzef rule? Only in E2. When you find E2 mechanism is working, then follow Sedzef rule. What Sedzef rule tells us that by the dehydrohalogenation, it will lead to the formation of that alkene which is major, more stable and having more alkyl groups. So whatever be the reaction, we have to search for that alkene in that compound which is major, which is more stable and having more alkyl groups attached to it. So E2 reaction, we know it's a one step reaction, so we just have to remove the proton from that side which leads to the formation of more stable alkene. Therefore we do not have to apply it E1. E1 is a two step reaction, we know that. In E1, the first step leads to carbocation, and we do not require the rule of Sedzef that we can do. Hum yahan kar sakte hai ki carbocation ko hum rearrange karke stabilize kar sakte hai. But in E2 reaction it's a one step reaction, so we cannot form a carbocation. तो इसलिए हमें यहां पर सेडजेफ रूल फॉलो करना पड़ता है. सिमिलरली उसी का उल्टा रूल है हॉफमैन्स रूल. जब भी बल्की और स्ट्रॉन्ग बेस आ जाते हैं, लाइक 83N एग्जांपल इज गिवन इन योर बुक, जब भी कोई बल्की और स्ट्रॉन्ग बेस आ जाता है तो उसको एक प्रोटॉन एक्सट्रैक्ट करने में बहुत आसानी होती है, ना कि कार्बोकैटायन बनाने में. अगर कार्बोकैटायन बना देता है दैट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट. सो व्हाट इज इजी फॉर द बल्की ग्रुप? To just extract a proton rather than the production of carbocation, which leads to formation of that alkene which is minor and less stable. For example, we take a reaction for Hofmann product, one Br, one CH3. If in the arrow it is written 83N or any of the bulky base, bulky, how do we know it's bulky? See, one nitrogen and three ethyl groups, which is very bulky. C2H5, C2H5, C2H5. So if it is given like this, and the other conditions, alcoholic KOH and other, for the dehydrohalogenation, we find two products, double bond CH2 and one CH2. यहाँ आपको देखने से पता चलेगा कि this is more stable because it has more alkyl groups attached to it, so it could be major. But according to the strong base or bulky base and the Hofmann rule, this is here the minor product and this is the major product. Since it is less stable, we know, but it's a major product because of the bulky base and the Hofmann's rule. Similarly, one reaction we see here. Same reaction we take. If it is written simple alcoholic KOH, example for Hofmann, let us see example for Sensef. We take a compound CH3CHCl CH CH3 CH3. Now this is a compound. Now we can, this is the alpha carbon, this is the beta, two beta carbons we are having. So we can remove a proton either from this position or this position. Now what we get from the two positions, let us see that. If we remove from this, then we get CH2 double bond CH, single bond CH, CH3 CH3. And if we remove from this a proton, then we get a second product. I am writing just about the place is not clear. CH3 CH double bond CH, not double bond CH, but if we remove a Cl from here and H from here, so double bond C CH3 and CH3. So we find that this is the major product. It is given in your book, you can see the two products, and this is the minor product. Why? Because according to Sadzef rule, if it is given only alcoholic KOH and a normal base, normal, not a bulky base, but it's a light base like RO negative form, then we have to follow Sadzef rule, and according to Sadzef rule, the major product is that product which is the most stable alkene. Since we find here that the carbocation form is somewhat here, so carbocation is more stable at this position, not at this position, because this is a 3 degree carbocation and this is 1 degree carbocation. So we find that 3 degree carbocation is more stable than the 1 degree carbocation. So we get this as a major product and this as a minor product. So we have to accordingly follow the rules at Sadzef or Hofmann. If we see a bulky base, then we have to follow Hofmann, and if we see a normal base, then we have to follow Sadzef. Similarly, we have to apply Sadzef in only E2, not E1, because E1 we already know that it follows through carbocation. So we have to see their most stable carbocation formation by rearrangement. Also in Hofmann, it is also given in your book that Hofmann elimination also takes place when the leaving group is poor. Now what is leaving group? Suppose we take an example, H, CH2, CH2, Cl. This group is called the leaving group. Now what we can have in place of X, we can have F, Cl, Br, I in form of negative. So their corresponding acids are HF, HCl, HBr, HI. Now HI is the strongest acid. So weakest base. Now what are leaving groups, and what, when we say that leaving group is poor, leaving group is said to be poor when it is a strong base. So if it is a weak base, then it is a good leaving group. But if it is a weak base, and weak base is I negative, if it was I negative, then it was a good leaving group. But if it is a strong base like F negative or Cl negative, it is a poor leaving group. So there we have to follow Hofmann. It is given very straightforward in page number 27. Is the vicinal dehalogenation. Dehalogenation means we have to remove halogen from the compound which is given so that we get the respective alkene. Now here we have given CH3, CH Br, CH Br, CH3. Now what happens? It can be done in presence of zinc or NaI. Zinc takes up two bromine molecules directly from it to form a side product ZnBr2, and instead we get a double bond in between so that we get the respective alkene. It can also be done by NaI and acetone. With sodium iodide in acetone, the mechanism is very well given in the book in page number 30, and with also zinc dust. So you have to study the mechanism, it is very well given in page 30. Now we study the fourth method of preparation, that is the acid catalyzed dehydration of alcohol. What happens in this reaction? We take a simple alcohol and dehydrate it in presence of some acid like H2SO4 concentrated or H3PO4 or P2O5 or anhydrous alumina. So what happens in presence of H plus ion? This takes an OH to form H2 as a side product, and instead we get an alkene. Now this point I will talk afterwards. First of all, we talk of the mechanism. Let us take an example of tert-butyl alcohol, CH3, 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 OH. We first of all, in the first step, we have protonation. What is protonation? Protonation is the attack by H positive ion on the OH group, like this. So what we have? CH3, C positive, CH3, CH3, minus H2. In the second step, we have, normally the carbocation can rearrange according to stability, and finally the deprotonation. Second step is deprotonation. CH3, C positive, CH3. One proton again removes from any of the carbon. Since it is symmetric, we can take from any carbon, and this bond transfers here so that we get the respective alkene. Double bond CH2 and CH3. There is a middle step, which is a fast step, that once the H positive attacks on OH, it forms OH2 there only in the form of an OH2 positive ion. This OH2 positive. Now this only removes from the molecule to form the carbocation. This is the middle step, which is fast reaction. This is the first step, which is the slow reaction. So it can be told in the two steps only, neglecting the middle step because it's just a intermediate step. So first step is the removal of OH or attack of the H plus on OH to form water as a side reaction, and we get the respective carbocation. And in the second step, it is the deprotonation to form the respective alkene. We will take one more important example of acid catalyzed dehydration. See, this is the molecule and we are providing H plus. So first of all, we will form the carbocation. Now, since it is a 1 degree carbocation, so we will do hydride shift such that it becomes a 2 degree carbocation, which is more stable than the 1 degree carbocation. Now what happens? We have studied the concept of ring expansion, that 4 sided ring is less stable than 5 sided ring. So if there is a condition that we can make the, or we can convert the 4 sided carbon ring to the 5 sided carbon ring, so we can do this by just transferring this bond to this position so that the positive sign on carbon, this carbon, comes to here carbon. So what we find, that I have written just similar way, the positive comes here and this bond just shifts here, so that we get a cyclopentane ring with a methyl group. Now the positive is on here. Now students will feel that now we have just got the final structure, but till now we haven't got the final structure. Now students can think that we can remove the proton from here and we can make the alkene like this, but this is wrong. Why? Because again we can convert this 2 degree carbocation into a further stable carbocation, that is a 3 degree carbocation, by doing the hydride shift from here. So by doing hydride shift, we get the positive sign on this carbon. Now we can remove the either hydrogens from here as a proton and we can get the respective alkene. So this is the major product and this is the final product we get in this question. Another question which is given in page 33 is something like this. It's just one methyl group is attached. Again we do the same step. We remove this and took a positive. Now students will think that one hydrogen is there, and since it is already at 2 degree, we can just do hydrogen shift. Then again we move closer to the ring and we can do just 5 member ring and so on. Just we have done in the previous example. But this is all not correct because already it is 2 degree. So why would it take to this carbon, this positive sign on this carbon, again it becomes a 2 degree. So what's the use? What's the advantage? Because यहाँ पर पहले से ही आपका 2 degree carbon बना हुआ है, यहाँ ले जाके कोई मतलब नहीं है, पहले से ही यह 2 degree बना रहेगा, यहाँ भी 2 degree, both the systems are stable, so we would not do the hydride shift here, just we will remove the proton from there only, from here or either. Now students will think from here or here. From here if you remove, then we get the double bond here, which is a less stable alkene because less substitution. So we will remove the proton from here. So we get this type of alkene. And the statement is given like this: that path, this hydride shift path, was incorrect as carbocation always rearranges to more stable carbocation as carbocation B is equally stable as A. This carbocation and this carbocation are same and they have same stability. So we have to keep in mind that whenever we are doing rearrangement, we should always go from a lower stable carbocation to a higher stable carbocation. See if we have 1 degree, we should try to go to 2 degree, try to go to 3 degree, or try to go to higher sided ring. You have to keep always this in mind. Now three more important points on dehydration: that reaction with 1 degree alcohol proceeds by E2 mechanism if steric hindrance is not present. That is, example C2H5OH will go by even mechanism, or the 1 degree alcohol, sorry, 1 degree alcohol proceeds by E2 mechanism, and the reaction if steric hindrance is not there, steric hindrance is not here because it's a very small group, so it will follow E2 mechanism. Now the reaction is first order. Reaction is first order as only one molecule is involved in the rate determining step. Now what we get here, as shown in the previous examples, sterically hindered alcohol is dehydrated by E1 mechanism. अगर यहाँ पर सोच लीजिए आगे बहुत लंबी सी कुछ बल्की सा ग्रुप होता, there would be a steric hindrance, so it will not follow by E2. Instead, even it will follow by E1 mechanism. One more important point about dehydration is that primary alcohols require the most stringent and most difficult conditions to undergo dehydration. As we have seen experimentally, if 1 degree alcohol is dehydrated, we require 180 degrees Celsius temperature and concentrated H2SO4. And for 3 degree alcohol, it is very easy because at 25 degrees Celsius and very diluted alcohol, very diluted sulfuric acid. Why? Because we find that 3 degree carbocation is very very stable and that state is reached very early instead of 1 degree carbocation. So what we find that 1 degree alcohol or the primary alcohol requires the most stringent conditions to undergo dehydration, and tertiary alcohols, that is the 3 degree alcohols, can be easily dehydrated by using 25% H2SO4 and 25 degrees Celsius. Now we see the next set of preparation of alkenes, that are the very simple and straightforward reactions, that are Hofmann and Wittig reaction. Hofmann elimination involves, Hofmann elimination is a process where an amine is reacted to create a tertiary amine I have directly shown, and in turn it is reacted by treatment with excess methyl iodide, followed by treatment with silver oxide and water and heat. After the first step, this is the first step, a quaternary ammonium iodide salt. This is a quaternary ammonium iodide salt. These are together, positive and negative species are together. So this is a salt, is created after replacement of iodine by an hydroxyl ion. This is the hydroxyl ion. An elimination reaction takes place to the alkene. This is the elimination reaction. This bond gets transferred here, and this as a proton is taken up by the OH negative to form water. With unsymmetrical amines, the major product is the least substituted and generally the least stable, an observation known as Hoffman rule. Now we have to take into consideration the Hoffman rule. What it says, with unsymmetrical amines, this is symmetrical amine, all are same. So with unsymmetrical amine, the major product is the least substituted and generally the least stable alkene, an observation known as Hoffman rule. This is in direct contrast to the normal elimination reaction where the more substituted stable product is dominant. This is the Sadseff rule. So this is very, very opposite to Sadseff rule. So you have to remember that you have to always follow Hoffman's rule in Hoffman elimination and form the least substituted and the least stable alkene possible. Now in the Whiting reaction, it's nothing but a convenient method of converting aldehydes and ketones, these are the aldehydes and ketones, into alkenes by using a special class of compounds called Whiting reagent. Whiting reagent is nothing but a phosphorus compound containing 3 phenyl rings and 2 alkyl groups. This is an R' compound. So after the reaction, this extracts an oxygen to form the side product PS3P double bond O and respective alkene. We can use R R' R' and R" as anything, H, methyl, phenyl, anything we can use, or any alkyl group. Now we see the next methods by preparation from ethers and esters. Now first the preparation from ether, cleavage of ethers. Cleavage of ethers means we have to just cut the ether from between. Now how can we cut this? We can take R-Na. R-Na is nothing but they are very strong bases such as alkyl sodium, alkyl lithium or sodamide. What happens here? First of all, this beta carbon H is there. R-dash part of this takes up the H and Na part takes the OR part, such that this bond gets transferred here to form the respective alkene and these are the side products. Now very, very important thing to note about this reaction is that this reaction is favored or aided by electron withdrawing group in the beta position. Now if in the beta position we have one electron withdrawing group, say Cl. If Cl was there, then the reaction would be fast and more favorable than nothing at this position. So what we find that if we have a Cl, then it as having an electron withdrawing group, then the reaction would be faster than the previous case when there is nothing at the beta position. Now we see the next set of preparation, that is the pyrolysis of esters. Pyrolysis of ester means it is the thermal cleavage of an ester, usually acetate, involves the formation of 6-membered ring as a transition state and leading to the elimination of acid leaving behind alkene. There is a transition state which is given very beautifully in the material. So I am just leaving that, I am finding the final product. Now how it happens? This is the ester we have taken. This is C double bond O methyl group and this is the rest of the alkyl group. Now what happens? The H bond comes here, this bond goes here and this bond goes here. So it starts forming a bond here, this bond starts breaking, so we in the form dotted lines. There is one bond forming starting here and this bond starts breaking. So I'm dotting and this bond starts forming. So very easily I have made the transition state which is given directly in your book. So what happens, this bond starts forming and finally it breaks up and alkene is formed with the ester or the methyl COOH. It is the acid. CH3COOH is an acid which is as a side product. So pyrolysis of ester and this cleavage of ether is a very simple point. You just need to take care that the very, very important, I have told this about ether, that electron withdrawing group is present. You must take care of that faster reaction and pyrolysis of ester with a cyclic transition state to form the respective alkene. And pyrolysis of ester with a cyclic transition state to form the respective alkene. Reactions of alkenes.